A very good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the day 3rd August 2021. So these are the list of news articles that we'll be discussing in today's analysis, and they're provided along with the page numbers of different editions and also the handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of different articles are given in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. So come, let us move into the first news article. Now look at this op-ed article. This is an article that tries to debate between national security and privacy. So in the course of our discussion, we will try to incorporate some important angles in the article. But however, our primary focus will be on debating between these two aspects, that is, between national security and privacy. And the entire discussion on this editorial is going to be more in the perspective of mains. See, usually in mains, a question pitching national security against privacy is a potential area. So let's consider a question of this sort, and the question goes like this: national security and privacy are two important aspects of governance of a democracy, but more often than not, one comes at the expense of another. Critically analyze. So as you can see, the questioner evidently asks you to analyze the facets of the issue in hand, that is, the issue of national security and privacy. See, when you take privacy, it assumed world recognition when the Snowden blew the ID of the US government snooping. And that is when privacy became a hot topic of contention in the new era of technology. Now let us see both the facets of the issue. Let us first start by siding with privacy, that is, by arguing in favor of privacy. See, privacy is based on the argument that every man is a king in his own house and no one dares to breach it. So that means an individual is entitled freedom of thought and action inside his own fort. And this has been recognized as early as 1763 by an English statesman, William Pitt. So basically, it is a violation of fundamental right, and this has been time and again emphasized. But however, it was concretely put down in our country by the Supreme Court in the famed Puttaswamy case only. And in this case, the Supreme Court recognized the right to privacy under Article 21. Now, another major argument that favors privacy, especially in a democracy, is that it limits the power of the government and it draws a line between the state and individual by emphasizing on individual freedom. And that is why privacy is important. Now, the next argument is that privacy will ensure a free and unhindered development of an individual. So, to understand this better, consider that someone is constantly watching you, or you can also consider a situation in which a teacher is watching your paper in the exam hall. Now, at such circumstances, even when you know the answer, you wouldn't want to write it. So logically speaking, under watchful eyes, one fails to perform to their full potential, and the efficacy and the creativity of the individual goes for a toss at such circumstances. And this is also a reason why privacy is important for the development of an individual. See, another important argument in favor of privacy is that in the era of internet, everything becomes public and individual choices are made public, and also the choices so made are weighed on individual and social ideologies. And in fact, recently, an advocate arguing for Puttaswamy case has rightly pointed out that the technology has advanced so much that what is whispered in the closet is heard in the street. So such is the intensity of privacy, especially with the growth of technology. So this blurring of distinction between public and private presents a case in favor of privacy. And apart from this, see, another important dimension of privacy in this modern era is this. Now think about someone hacking into a phone. And in that case, besides personal information, one's financial details also becomes apparent. And this gives the hacker who hacked into a private phone a free access to the money resources of an individual. And the lack of privacy makes it further easier for the hacker to do this unethical act. And this is also a reason why privacy is being emphasized. And consider this also, the leaked personal data has nowadays been used freely to fake the identity of a person. And this is especially dangerous if it gets into the hands of dangerous antisocial organizations. And this is another reason why the importance of privacy repeatedly emphasized. Now in the next part, we'll see some arguments as to why privacy has to be honored by the government. That means now we are going to see why a state cannot intrude into the lives of a citizen, and also why it has to safeguard the data that it has collected from a citizen. That means in this part, we are going to throw light on the reasons as to why the state cannot intrude into the lives of a citizen, and we will also see as to why it has prioritized the need to safeguard the data that it has collected from the citizen. You can understand this in the context of Aadhaar and all, and as we know, the government has been collecting a lot of data in that direction. The first and foremost reason is that privacy is a pre-existing natural right which is inherent in the constitution, and even though it is not explicitly mentioned, this puts an obligation on the state to protect individual privacy. Secondly, the collection of large data and surveilling the citizens can actually act as a tool with the government to adversely discriminate between its citizens. And this makes a strong point in favor of privacy from the government. And lastly, India has got an obligation to honor international treaties that have clauses relating to the protection of citizens' privacy. Remember, India is a signatory to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which also talked of the right to privacy of individuals, and that is also one major reason why government has to respect individual privacy. So these are broadly the arguments in favor of privacy. Now let us move on to see why national security is more important than privacy. See, for a state, national security is a liability. It is a necessity that a government should provide to its citizens. And this national security involves a literal question of the right to life under Article 21, and on the other hand, privacy is a luxury when national security is under threat, and that is why many states, they put national security on top of privacy. The next and the most famous argument for national security is that if one has nothing to hide, then why does he or she needs privacy? Note that an argument that is commonly presented against privacy is about corporate players. See, when we become a part of Facebook, or say you want to shop in Myntra, they ask you a lot of personal details, and what we do is we readily comply and give them out. But we have apprehensions when the government asks for the same, and then the fear of surveillance comes into question. But in reality, all the e-commerce entities are actually utilizing the data and the search patterns in order to monitor our behaviors and also to sell products to us. So this is a kind of manipulative act from the corporate. So the question here is, why can't the government take your information to protect you while a corporate can use it to make money? So this has been a famous argument whenever we talk about national security. And another justification for national security is that the wider net of national security measures can actually identify racially or religiously motivated criminals, and it enables the government to act against them before any harm is caused to others. Or in other words, prevention is possible with surveillance, and that is why privacy is not a priority. So these are some of the arguments in favor of as well as against privacy and national security. But think about this, national security and privacy are different sides of the same coin. An individual who is accorded with the right to privacy enjoys freedom and feels secure in his own country. And remember, national security is not only about security, but it is also about the individual well-being. So the right to privacy given emphasis will only aid in the big picture of the national security. But however, students are free to take your own stand on this issue. So with this, we have come to the end of this discussion. Now let's move to the next news article. Now for our next news discussion, we have chosen this op-ed article. In our discussion, we are going to see about deep work, and then we will see about the present hurdles or the kind of obstacles that we face when it comes to the promotion of deep work, and we will also see the significance of deep work. So come, let us go into the discussion. The syllabus covered by this article is highlighted below for your reference. See, as we all know, the National Education Policy of 2020 has rightfully identified the 21st century skills to be fundamental for developing creators. Now, having said that, you may have a question on what are these 21st century skills. See, the 21st century skills refers to the skills like critical thinking, problem solving, communication, innovation, flexibility, self-direction, social and cultural interactions, and also productivity and accountability. See, these skills are really essential when it comes to the development of creators. So, having seen the skills, the next question that comes to our mind is the ways that we can develop these skills. See, according to the author, we need to deep work in order to develop these skills. See, this term deep work refers to a design-based approach wherein the students will concentrate on a subject for 2 to 3 weeks. And in that time period of 2 to 3 weeks, the students will examine the extent to which the subject can be applied in the real world. See, engaging with deep work actually motivates an individual to remain immersed or to remain connected in a specific activity. And this immersion or this connect will make the individual happy as well as creative. And apart from this, it will impart the 21st century skills in that particular individual. But the issue is, our current education system does not support this deep work. This is because our current education system relies on a heavy content-based syllabus, and it only promotes traditional literacy and numeracy, and it gives very little space or flexibility for the students to be immersed in such specific activity. And similarly, even our current teachers are trained by the traditional educational system, and even they lack the capacity to train our students using deep work. Now, apart from this, there is also another issue. As we know, the corona pandemic has forced us to adopt an online form of education. Now, because of this, we are in a situation where we heavily rely on technology for education. Now, this over-reliance on technology also comes at a cost. That is, see, the technological tools that we are engaging with are actually forcing the human beings to remain as consumers rather than becoming creators. Now, it is said so because the contemplation and the engagement are actually missing when it comes to the online form of education. And adding to this, see, the children have also lost personal contact with their social group due to this online education. So all these things or all these changes are actually affecting deep work. This is because online education lacks the emotional and social engagement that is required for deep work. Now, moving on to the next question. So what can be done to overcome this challenge? See, our educators need to find ways to upgrade their engagement strategies, and they should create hybrid learning by integrating technology, because without such upgradation, emotional and social engagement will continue to be missing from online education, and it will also affect the immersion, which will in turn affect the deep work. Now, coming to the last part of this editorial discussion, see, the author here cites a study that highlights the significance of deep work. Now, let us discuss the study. See, in a semester-long study, around 65 pre-service teachers were asked to improve the pages on Wikipedia related to educational concept. But only a few participants were actually successful in improving the pages, and most of them failed. See, this is because many of the content were found to be plagiarized, and the content also lacked proper citations. And apart from this, basic writing and grammar skills were also missing in many contents. So due to these defects, the contents were either sent back to the participants or they were deleted by the editors of Wikipedia. But the study doesn't end there. See, these unsuccessful participants who failed in improving the pages of Wikipedia were given training after that, and the training was featured in such a way that it was immersive, emotionally connective, and also constantly engaging. So deep work was infused in their approach, and once they got done with this deep work, the teachers were actually successful in improving the pages, and they successfully contributed content to over 75 Wikipedia articles in English, and also they contributed content to over 50 articles in languages like Kannada, Tamil, Telugu, Hindi, Malayalam, Gujarati, Assamese, and Punjabi. So this shows or this highlights that constant engagement, emotional connect and immersive learning are important parts of successful education, and all these parts can be effectively provided by deep work. So with this we have come to the end of this discussion. So far in this discussion we had a very comprehensive analysis on what is deep work, and we also saw the present state of this deep work, wherein we focused on various obstacles that is actually preventing deep work from being effectively utilized. And towards the end of the segment, we saw a case study wherein the significance of deep work was brought to light. So with this, now let's move on to the next news article. Now let us take up this news article. This article is regarding an observation made by the Supreme Court on passing a preventive detention order. And this judgment has come as a result of an appeal that was filed by a wife of a man who was placed under preventive detention shortly after he was granted bail in a cheating case. So now, before moving on to the judgments made by the court, first let us get a brief understanding about preventive detention. And for that, we need to discuss Article 22 of the Indian Constitution. As we know, this article, that is Article 22 of the Indian Constitution, deals with protection against arrest and detention in certain cases, and it also provides safeguards against the misuse of police powers when it comes to arrest and detention. Now see, this fundamental right of Article 22 is covered in two major parts. The first part is about the protection and rights granted in case of punitive detention. Now here, this punitive means to punish a person for an offense that was committed by a person after trial and conviction in a court. Remember, it is to punish a person for an offense that was committed by a person after trial and conviction in a court. And an example for this can be the case of Om Prakash Chautala, a four-time chief minister of Haryana. And this person had to serve a 10-year jail term in Tihar following his conviction in government job recruitment scam that took place in 2013. Now coming to the next part of the right, see, this part is related to the safeguards against preventive detention. Now coming to preventive detention, see, this is related to detaining a person without trial and conviction. I'll repeat, this is to detain a person without trial and conviction. Here you should remember one thing. See, preventive detention is not to punish a person for past offense. As the term preventive suggests, this preventive detention is used to prevent not for a past offense, but rather to prevent him or her from committing an offense. And this is very well made clear from the title itself, and this is one of the reasons why it is called as preventive detention, that is to prevent a person from committing an offense. So it can be said that preventive detention is a kind of precautionary measure that is used by the government. And an example for this could be the arrest of the leaders of the Elgar Parishad under the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act of 1967 related to Bhima Koregaon violence. Now let us see some important provisions of this Article 22. Now when you take Clause 2 of this Article 22, it says that every person who is arrested or detained in custody shall be produced before the nearest magistrate within a period of 24 hours of such arrest. And this period of 24 hours excludes the time necessary for the journey from the place of arrest to the court of magistrate. And this clause also says that no person shall be detained in custody beyond the set period without the authority of a magistrate. Now coming to clause 4 of this act, see, this clause 4 of the article states that no individual can be detained for more than 3 months. Remember, no individual can be detained for more than 3 months unless a bench of high court judges or an advisory board decides to extend the date. Likewise, clause 5 of this article states that the detained individual should definitely be made aware of the grounds that he or she has been detained for, and this clause also says that they should be provided with an opportunity of making a representation against the case. And when you take clause 7 of this Article 22, it says that the parliament may by law prescribe the circumstances under which a person may be detained for a period longer than 3 months, and this can be done under any law providing for preventive detention without obtaining the opinion of an advisory board. So these are some of the important provisions related to preventive detention. Now let's move on to see the observations made by the court in this regard. Now let us see the observations that was made by the Supreme Court in this regard. So far from the discussion, we know that preventive detention gives the state the power to detain a person without trial, and Supreme Court said that such an order can only be used or can only be passed if a person's activities adversely affect or his or her activities is likely to adversely affect the maintenance of public order. And the court also stressed that preventive detention should be used only to prevent public order, and the judgment also highlighted the need for courts to ensure that the facts presented in front of it leads to harm, danger or a feeling of insecurity among the general public or any section, and only if it satisfies such conditions the court should make use of this function. And as per the judgment, preventive detention must fall within the four corners of Article 21, which deals with due process of law. That has to be read with Article 22, which is about safeguards against arbitrary arrest and detention, and statute in question. See, the court has emphasized such concerns since the power of preventive detention must be confined to narrow limits, because otherwise there is a lot of possibility for it to threaten the great right to liberty that was won by our freedom fighters after a long, hard ways and historical struggles. So these are some of the important takeaway points that we need to have in mind with respect to this particular news article. So now let us move on to the next news discussion. Now we have taken this news article for our discussion. With increased inflow, some crest gates have been lifted from the Nagarjuna Sagar Dam. So in this context, let us know about this Nagarjuna Sagar from the preliminary exam point of view. See, the dam is built over River Krishna, and this dam is considered to be one of the largest dams built in the recent times in Asia. And this dam derives its name from a nearby hillock and island called Nagarjuna Konda, where an ancient Buddhist guru had once lived. Note that it is the tallest masonry dam in India. And see, the project has a catchment area of roughly 2,15,000 square kilometer, and this project is also said to be the largest canal system network in India. Remember that the mighty dam has got a majestic height of 124 meters and it is 1 kilometer long and has got 26 crest gates, and this dam can store up to 11,472 million cubic meters of water in the reservoir. And for your information, this project commenced in the month of February in 1956, and after a brief gap due to lack of modern equipment, this project was constructed with stone rather than concrete, and the dam was fully completed only in the year 1972 once the crest gates were installed. See, one of the noteworthy facts is that the dam is also one of the earliest projects that was built in post-independence India for irrigation as well as for the purpose of hydroelectricity generation. And in fact, this dam is among the first irrigation projects that was started by the Indian government as an element of green revolution. And also note that exclusively for the purpose of tourism, a lake has been developed behind the dam, and this lake is said to possess the status of the third largest man-made lake anywhere in the world. And today, apart from offering not only irrigation facility, this Nagarjuna Sagar Dam is also a source of hydroelectricity, and this dam attracts a huge number of tourists owing to its great magnificence as well as the cover of the dense green surrounding that it offers. And in the vicinity, we also have Nagarjuna Sirisalam Wildlife Sanctuary. So these are some of the takeaway points from this article. Now let's move on to the next news discussion. So in this part, we will be having a quick discussion on the news, and we will also revise the points that we have previously learnt. So now let's see them one by one. First, let us take up this news article. The article talks about the situation of Zika virus in Maharashtra, and the news reports that a multidisciplinary team has been sent to Maharashtra for the sake of monitoring the Zika virus situation and also to support the state government in the management of infections. So this is the news. So in this context, we are now going to see some important facts related to Zika virus in the prelims perspective. See, Zika Zika is a viral infection that is caused by mosquitoes, and the infection is transmitted by the bite of an infected mosquito. So the main vector causing this infection is Aedes aegypti mosquito, which is a mosquito from the Aedes genus. An important point that you need to keep in mind here is that this is the same mosquito that transmits diseases like dengue, chikungunya and yellow fever. And usually these mosquitoes, they have a tendency to bite during the day, especially in the morning and late afternoon or late evening. And also note that mosquito is not the only reason for the spread, since apart from mosquito bite, the virus is also transmitted through sexual activity with the infected people. And generally, the incubation period for this Zika virus is estimated to be 3 to 14 days. So by now, we have a kind of understanding about the virus and its cause. So now let us move on to the symptoms of this particular infection. See, a majority of people, they do not develop symptoms. And even if they develop any symptoms, it will generally be mild fever, rash, muscle and joint pain, malaise and headache, etc. Though it does not cause any serious implications on an ordinary basis, the concern here is in the case of pregnant mothers, since infection among the pregnant mothers has got the potential to pose serious complications in them, because there are possibilities for this infection to result in microcephaly and Guillain-Barré syndrome. See, this microcephaly is a birth defect wherein a baby's head is smaller than expected, and also when compared to other babies of the same sex and age. And when you take the Guillain-Barré syndrome, it is a kind of neurological disorder that could actually lead to paralysis and death. Going by the lines of the popular quote, prevention is always better than cure. Now let's see some preventive measures in this regard. So obviously, reducing the incidence of mosquito bites is an important aspect when it comes to preventing this disease. And this could be done by using mosquito nets, preventing water stagnation, by keeping the surroundings clean and measures like that. And adding to this, the use of contraceptives to prevent sexual transmission can also be a viable option. So these are some of the points that you need to have in your mind whenever you learn about Zika virus. Now with these details in mind, let's move on to the next article. Now look at this news article about black fungus. As per the news article, Andhra Pradesh has reported the third biggest tally of mucormycosis, which is also known as the black fungus, in the country. So based on this news article, we will see some important facts about this mucormycosis. See, as we know, the second wave of corona pandemic witnessed several cases of fungal infections in several states. And so far, we have come across funguses like black, white, yellow, etc. But since our news today talks about the black fungus, we are going to focus only on that. See, as we know, funguses are a kind of organisms which are different from the plants and animal kingdoms. And these organisms are found throughout the natural environment, and along with bacteria, they actually play a very important role in our ecosystem by degrading the organic matter into simpler forms for the consumption of plants. Now coming to mucormycosis, so it is a serious but rare fungal infection, and it is caused by a group of moles called mucormycetes. And during the infection, the fungus forms black color colonies in infected tissues. And it is because of this blackening of tissues, this fungus has got its name as black fungus. Now remember, these fungi are angioinvasive. So what it does is that it causes invasion of tissues and blood vessels, and thereby it interrupts the blood supply to normal tissues. So when it interrupts the blood supply to normal tissues, it will result in the color changing to black, and eventually it destroys the tissues, resulting in tissue necrosis and death. Now one good news is that the disease is not contagious and it doesn't spread from one person to another. But instead of that, this fungus, they get transmitted through air. This is because these moles, they live throughout the environment and their spores are found in the air. So due to this, there are high chances for them to get lodged in the nasal cavity and adjoining sinuses during the process of inhalation. And for your information, this fungi is known to be causing opportunistic infections, that is, to cause sickness in people with weakened immune system. And since mucormycosis mostly affects persons who are already sick from other medical conditions, it is quite difficult to know which symptoms are actually related to this particular disease. But however, the popular symptoms that are associated with this black fungus are pain and redness around eyes, fever, headache, coughing, shortness of breath, then bloody vomits, and also altered mental status. And the warning signs of this disease includes toothache, loosening of teeth, blurred or double vision with pain. So some good measures to prevent this mucormycosis: the usage of masks while visiting dusty construction sites, and the practice of wearing shoes, long trousers or long sleeved shirts and gloves while carrying out gardening, and also maintaining personal hygiene. So with this revision on mucormycosis, we will now go on to the next part of our Indonews analysis, that is the practice question discussion. Now look at this question: match the dam with the river. See, we saw in the discussion that Nagarjuna Sagar Dam is built over Krishna. So one is matched with B. And when you take the Krishna Raja Sagar Dam, it is built on Kaveri. So that makes two with A. And then the Pong Dam, which is also called as Maharana Pratap Sagar, is built over Bias. And that makes three with C. So therefore, the correct answer here is option A, that is 1B, 2A and 3C. Now look at this prelims practice question. With reference to preventive detention in India, consider the following statements. See, from our discussion, it is clear that statement 1 is correct and it is mentioned in article 22. Now coming to statement 2, see, this statement is also correct. See, here we must know entry 3 of list 3 of the concurrent list of the 7th schedule of our constitution, because under entry 3 list 3, the parliament as well as the state legislatures can concurrently make a law for reasons connected with security of state, maintenance of public order or maintenance of supplies and services that are essential to the community. But preventive detention for reasons connected with defense, foreign affairs or the security of India is an exclusive domain of the parliament, and this is found in entry 9 of the union list. And since both options that are given here are correct, the right answer here is option C, that is both 1 and 2. The list of mains practice question is highlighted below, so you can write your answers and post them in the comment section. So with this, we have come to the end of today's Hindu News analysis. So if you like the video, then don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates regarding UPSC Civil Services preparation.